The talk is called "A Tale of Four Cities," and I'll shortly explain why. And am I correct? Someone just confirmed that there are many architects in the audience today, because of a
Yes.
wonderful,
Yes, I can.
wonderful, good. Because this is a largely architectural slash heritage talk, which underscores really the fact that architecture, as I like to say, architecture is heritage, and heritage is architecture. So, but I'd like to talk just briefly about how I met, how I met HCS, and then how HCS affected my practice. So those will be my first two slides. I actually first met HCS via a tour I was invited to, one of the earlier members of the board of the Heritage Conservation Society, Maribel Longpin, invited me to a tour being given of this building in Manila called Gota de Leche. I had just this was in the early part of the 2000s. I had just newly returned to the Philippines from study and work in the US. And so this is a great opportunity for me to get to know Manila again. And the person giving the tour was Augusto Villalon. Gota de Leche, as you can see here, designed by Arcadio Arellano, largely based on the design for the Ospedale degli Innocenti in Florence by Filippo Brunelleschi, was also then restored by Augusto Villalon. And I remember the experience. He was walking us around, and this room behind which you see the sign Gota de Leche. It was an upper room with such architectural elegance and felicity that I was moved by the space, you know. And I think that's already a clue to the link between architecture and heritage, and really the idea of the confluence between the two and how they really are in many ways one, you know, because you are moved neither by the you know, neither by just one or the other. You are moved by a space, in this case by Gota de Leche, that upper room. And so I joined HCS, and I'm so glad I did, because the way that it influenced my work and my thought was substantial, was really substantial. Our first big break as a firm was the rebuilding of Magallanes Church after the fire. The church was the building was designed by Leandro Locsin, but I remember after the fire, you know, it is an open question, and there were some people wondering, you know, do we keep it, you know, can we demolish it, you know, architect, you know, can we just demolish it, you can just start something entirely new. But I remember that the intellectual framework that the Heritage Conservation Society had begun to inculcate in me, you know, really made me feel very strongly that whatever survived of the fire should be sustained to help tell the story of community and to help make a richer environment for the new architectural reality that was to take place. Take a note also of the, you know, of the way the dome and the clay tile, the profile of that. You'll see something similar to it later. And then more recently, the National Museum of Natural History, you know, the experience, the exposure that HCS brought to me, rendered me more confident about how to deal with structures, how to listen to structures. Because, you know, really, we as architects, we must be building whisperers, you know? We must learn to understand what the building is trying to say, what the building significance is. And in the case of this museum, this is very clear. You know, the idea of the dome anchored very set squarely in the centroid of this whole structure, so it is seismically autonomous from the surrounding structure, but at the same time creating a presence in the urban landscape. So very briefly then, I this notion, the tale of four cities, has to do with a recent trip. Actually, I'm just back from about 3 to 4 weeks that my family and I spent in Italy. And just a word about Italy. When I was a student of architecture, the third year or the junior year of our school of architecture, the University of Notre Dame, was in Rome. So we were in Rome for a year, and that experience was extremely formative. And so this recent chance to visit Italy again was for me very providential. And I'd been to Italy a couple of times since I was in school, but this particular time, as an architect in practice, approaching 60, was a meaningful opportunity for me to reassess and to understand what I know, you know, what I know in architecture. So this is going to be a bit a kind of a, like a travelogue. It's a mixture of photographs and sketches showing us the context of what we saw. But let me start with, I want to begin with this a picture of, this was Milan. There was this very generous seating arrangement. And I thought, oh, how nice. How about a nice civic gesture on this square, right? And you know, in front of this post office building, you know, you get to sit down. But I saw this constant line of people going into the building. It turns out it was a, you know, this post office, this patrimonial structure in Milan was a post office, and now was a new Starbucks. It was full, you know, and it was it struck me because, you know, the news of the fire in our own post office was very fresh in my mind, and so to see how this structure, even older, I think, than the Manila Central Post Office, here fully alive as a Starbucks. You know? Interesting. If you just notice the sign on the under poste, right? It's hard to see, but it's a Starbucks coffee roastery. So you know, it didn't have to call out the commercial aspect of the site, but it was no less effective. So from there, I took a walk from this piazza, this Piazza Cardosio, and I was heading towards the Galleria Vittorio Emanuele, and I was struck by this experience, which I think, you know, we architects are all and everyone is actually aware of, the idea of how the city, as you move through it, is an ever-evolving frame, of a reality in the distance that is of interest, of visual interest, and which underscores the fact that, you know, a city is not just its individual buildings, a city is also its context. You know, it's also the fabric of the city, of made up of the buildings that frame an unfolding vista, right? And so what I found interesting was this this series of images as approaching Galleria Vittorio Emanuele, and how the dome that had been, you know, it had been very frank in how, you know, the construction of the dome was from a distance. But as we approached it, that frankness disappeared because we were going to now see the intended impact of the dome, the intended impact of that space, and you know, to reveal its full glory as we go in. And so it moved me such that I made a sketch of it, and that brings me to a first practical point I'd like to share with the architects here, is to have a sketchbook. I actually, you know, normally just, you know, bring my camera, my phone's my camera, but I'm so glad that for this trip, I brought this bunch of small sketchbooks. I don't know where they come from, but they became so important for my experience, because I was able to as the thoughts were occurring, as the observations were occurring, I was able to, like, to observe, to jot them down. And so here, the previous series of pictures that you saw, I want to diagram what is this notion of the ephemeral frame, what is this notion of this unfolding vista, and what the city does is it creates a this series, almost this infinite number, if you will, of ephemeral frames that bring you to a place, right? And there already is an aspect of the significance of a context, the significance of a if you will, of a heritage context, because it frames and it deepens your connection to a site that you're approaching. The next sketch is another actually important experience for me, is the notion of, well, it's the signifier and the signified, because going to it's something that because I also design churches, and so the experience of the relationship, of understanding the relationship between architectural form and architectural meaning and other meanings is very important in the work that we do. By the way, as I say these things about other things other than heritage, know that under all this is a subtext of heritage, the subtext of experiencing these different places, these different sites, for which we are grateful, eternally grateful that they still exist to teach us. They still exist to provide us these experiences that provide us insight. And so in this particular case, this notion of this relationship between, this small red light, right, in the middle of this vast space in this church of San Fedele in Milan, it really brought home, this introspection about the relationship between what is signified and what signifies it, which is really re at the heart of architecture. So that's the first of the four cities. The next city is Venice. It was, the just to it was Milan, Venice, Florence, and Rome, right? So now we go to Venice. Venice is important because, in my personal experience, because when I was a student, the experience of the first contact with the architect Carlo Scarpa was monumental for me. And it was actually in this building, the Palazzo Querini Stampaglia, which was renovated by Carlo Scarpa. And I remember the impact it had on me. The impact had to do with how rich the dialogue is or can be between the old and new. It is not old architecture, new architecture. It is a new composite reality of the timeless and the sublime that comes from this dialogue between old and new. And I'm showing this bridge because it's a fantastic bridge that takes you. This was the entrance to this museum. It's a museum, actually. It's a palazzo. It's now a museum. And the this was how I entered this building in 1986, this beautifully detailed bridge, right? It's not because the complex has grown, it's different now. You don't enter through here. But these are, I remember that, what's interesting about this, the feeling, the connection with the timeless impact from 1986, the way it hit me then, hit me again now, right? The way that Scarpa was able to use architectural form, new form, and creative play of materials to have this dialogue between the old brick, the old stone, the new brick, the new stone, and of course the water that's always there, right? So, this is, I said, what, how wonderful, how creative, how so consummately intriguing, right? And so this is where it began really for me as a, I guess you could say heritage conservation began for me here, right? Where it could be so exciting. It was not, moribund or museological. It was alive. It was contemporary. It was meeting current needs, right? But also, of course, confronting evolving realities. I think the way that he created this new floor because of the constant threat of aqua alta or high water, right? And this beautiful, you know, the way that he superimposes new material over the old stairs, you know. You know, the old stairs are still actually whatever Scarpa did in the Palazzo Grid Stampaglia, you can take out, and the old palazzo will still be there, right? But of course, you know, thankfully that won't be necessary because it's such a beautiful a work of architecture. And you know, there's exhibition space, and I at the end of the exhibition space, on the way to the garden, I just want to point out this stone door. Right, this is the view of the stone door from the exhibition space, because I'll show you where that comes from. Right, the stone door from the exhibition space, the stone door from the other side, and this is as you're entering, as you head towards the garden, and you know the inside is sublime, the outside is sublime. This garden is an homage to water. You know, it's an homage to Venice. Note the use of mosaic. I mean, there was mosaic everywhere, as you could see earlier in earlier pictures. But it was a contemporary response to the timelessness of Venice, you know, and you know the use of mosaic, the use of water to tell this narrative was it hit me again, you know, it hit me again very strongly. In fact, I couldn't, first of all, we didn't have time. I could only take pictures, but all I could put in my sketchbook was this, you know, the love that generated the form and the love that the form generates. I think it's also in, you know, the significance of architecture and heritage. Architecture and its heritage context. You know, I mean, there's a connection through time. You know, through the earlier times, through history, and through where we are now, all expressed in architectonic form. So it's interesting then to consider the context of Venice, where Scarpa was from, and clearly you can see that, you know, the influence of the Byzantine in his work, because the context of Venice was there when he was creating. You know, it had not been foolishly demolished to make way for some, you know, a banal monstrosity, right? It was there to teach Scarpa, you know, this the Basilica di San Marco. You know, I was showing you in the earlier slide. You know, this was instructive. It's instructive to Scarpa. It's instructive to us who go see it. I mean, this is a floor that can move you to tears with its beauty. And here's another site, the church in Torcello, and I'm sure it's an ancient church, not in as good of shape as San Marco, but I'm sure it's because so there's the you can see the interior and the sketch I did shows the relationship between the north wall on the left, which has no windows, and you can see on the right there are windows, which and those windows on the right are those windows you see out here. Those are stone shutters, which I remember Carlo Scarpa in YouTube, actually YouTube documentary, that he was talking about how the stone that the door that you see in that you saw in the Palazzo Corini Stampaglia that I pointed out earlier was very much influenced by this, right? So this underscores the fact that we as architects are inspired and energized by the context that is not just of the now, you know, but we are energized by a context that begins much earlier, you know, that begins in the earliest of times. So that's Venice. So now we go to the third city. We go to Florence, Florence was a place that reinforced this notion of the ephemeral frame. If there's any place which I had pointed out earlier in Milan, but here in Florence, it was I feel even exceptionally strong with the way that the landscape, the urban landscape, frames a site that you're approaching. And in this case, it is approaching the Ospedale degli Innocenti, the complex of this orphanage, the Hospital of the Innocents that was designed by Filippo Brunelleschi. Recall what I had mentioned earlier about the Gotta di Lecce designed by Arcadio Aureliano, and also consider how the importance, therefore, of the history of architecture in the work we do today as architects, because you know, we don't just, of course, we deal with current realities, we deal with current needs, present day requirements, but what helps bring depth and meaning to our responses is a broad view, a broad and a deep view of the history of architecture. So here, as we approach along this street, approaching this site that inspired Arcadio Aureliano's Gotta di Lecce, and note this by Filippo Brunelleschi, noted this early instance of the Renaissance, the Italian Renaissance in architecture, is this elegant arches and the blue rondelles by Della Robbia, and again, furthering this notion of how a context frames a view from the side of Filippo Brunelleschi's Ospedale degli Innocenti. We look in the other direction down the street, and we see in other of his works the Duomo, the Cathedral of Florence. And these next few images are an unfolding, you know, and this is the delight. This is the deep delight of visiting a city where there is a context, right? And it should therefore serve to inspire us as we create today's cities, that there is a role to be played about texture on surfaces. You know, I mean, we look at it in the Philippine setting, the texture surfaces that we used to have in the 1950s and 60s, you know, with the brisolet that is with an excellent tropical response. I mean, today is supplanted by these banal sheets of undelineated glass, you know, so sleek but so fleeting, right? As opposed to the notion of texture on surface that with each passing step, as we approach a site, you know, gives frames that site with an evolving richness, right? And I also would like to point out that there was when we were doing Mogelliano series, St. Alfonso series, there was in the back of our heads, you know, this recollection of this large terracotta roof, you know, so underscoring, you know, what is really, you know, what enriches architecture is the way that a specific response is really part of a larger cosmology of architectural reality. So, and this is really what's really always wonderful as an experience is really how detail change, how detail grows, how you get to understand a building as you approach it. Of course, it's an essential and basic truth, you know, that as you get close to something, you get to see it in greater detail. But, you know, for us as architects, because we deal with detail, you know, it has a special resonance for us. So now the last of the four cities, Rome. Rome, where I was a student, and the school, our lodgings and our studio were in the historic center between the Pantheon and Piazza Navona. And I was fortunate that in this last trip, you know, our hotel had this view from the breakfast terrace off the Pantheon, and had a chance to get to know it again, and to recall my experience as a student of being able to, on the way to get lunch, being able to go into the bathroom and just experience the space, experience the way that the light comes in. I think that this experience of seeing how light comes in, you experience it in the bathroom, but you also experience it in any space of significance. And because that is, you know, our churches here, especially our colonial era churches, you know, with their thick walls and the way that light comes in these shafts as they break through the mist of time, if you will, they move you to and they educate you, you know. And so the way that the light was coming into this space when I was a student moved me and educated me, and it has thus continued and continues to inform the work I do. So I, as I said earlier, I just want to underscore, you know, how I'm grateful I am. I brought my sketchbooks, this new sketchbooks, because it's me. I used to sketch when I was a student, you know, and this serendipitous bringing of these sketchbooks revived this idea, you know, not just depending on the camera, but also to sketch, you know, this quick sketches. As I wrote here, you know, one can sketch then photograph, right? You sketch it, then you photograph it. And the experience helps to learn the learnings to be learned from this, from a significant site. This one, just to underscore the idea, the importance of sketching. It is actually a sketch I did on the car on the way to the airport. You know, I saw something. It was in my memory. It's no longer there, but it's in my memory, and I sketched it. It was of this in, on the outskirts of Rome. View from the car bringing us to Fiumicino, layer of trees floating on hilly landscape like cloud cover. You know, again, I share this just to underscore the importance of sketching. Okay, so Rome. These are the next few images, are images actually of a building on the Via del Corso. It used to be a bank or an insurance company headquarters, and now it's Apple by the office of Norman Foster. And I've always liked actually how Norman Foster's team engages with a patrimonial structure in a way that respects the structure, but also creates a new and interesting architecture. You know, there's an interesting dialogue that creates. Is this phenomenon? I'm looking at this splendid detail of wall and jam and baseboard and floor, how they meet, and then you can see through the glass, right? You can see through the glass the central stairs. You can see here in the upper right, and also the reflection of the front facade behind us and the Apple insignia. And the rusticated base of the building across the street, you know. So there's one thing great about cities that can provide this experience of the layers of time, right? In the here and now we see past and present together. Right? So that stair that you saw here through that glass on the upper right is the stair. You know, it's the stair was restored. Just this, the simple gesture of the thin bronze rail is a modern adjustment to building and safety code. So it's a wonderful dialogue where the patrimonial has right of way, if you will, but the present day is still the present day needs are still met. Sharing again, you know, the kind of precise and exquisite detail that can happen in this particular, you know, case of adaptive reuse, which is an important means of enabling old heritage structures to continue serving humanity today, and how in adaptive reuse, you know, what's significant is shown, is shared, is framed, as you can see in that the ceiling fresco. And of course, what's significant about building the relationship in the interior and the courtyard is sustained and provides, again, a poetic context. So there you see the patrimonial ceiling in this new environment. Okay, I think this is I'm going out to my last couple of slides, and this has to do with St. Peter's, an experience actually that the learning in St. Peter's Basilica, right? That is this wonderful this masterpiece of the Renaissance, not just in architecture but also in art, as you can see here on the right, this image of the Pietà. This sculpture done by Michelangelo, right? This Pietà is Italian for compassion. So this image of compassion, you know, it's near the entrance to St. Peter's. It's moving, right? It's a moving work of sculpture in this sublime work of architecture. But one thing that struck me in this visit was, You notice, in the architectural form, you notice the bases. You see the people sitting at these volutes at the base of these giant columns, giant pilasters. At the base of them, you know, there's enough of a volute that someone can sit on it, you know. And I went as a student, you know, quite often to St. Peter's just to experience this space. But in this current visit, only did it hit me in a particular way, right? That this large space had at its feet a gift, you know? So, you know, I sketch it. It is this, on, you know, from the great height of the architectural empyrean, the pilaster bases are benches that give us rest. And so it was at that, you know, a kind of, in its own way, an architectural version of the Pietà, you know, architecture as an instrument of compassion, right? And it is also one reason why heritage is important, because it is a lexicon of how architecture, how built structure through time has been an instrument of compassion. An instrument of love, if you will.